Hello, comrades. Our glorious leader, Mikhail Gorbachev, has passed away at the grand age of 91, which is, on average, higher than those capitalist Americans. Gorbachev died of long illness. And we'd like to remind you that anyone who questions the passing of our leader's death will spend time in the gulag. Rest in peace, our glorious leader. Comrade Sean, how has this devastating news affected you?
I think it's Mikhail Gorbachev.
Well, it looks like I'm in the gulag for not saying his name right.
Well, I think one of the things that's happened is the theory that Mikhail Gorbachev was the beast, or
yes,
the Antichrist.
The mark of the beast.
Because when I was a young fella, because it was like combating between Mikhail Gorbachev and Ronald Reagan.
Yes.
Remember the famous line of Ronald Reagan?
Oh, yes, the famous line.
At the German, West German wall.
Yes, I do have that famous line. Give me one momento. One momento. Okay, because we're almost there. Almost here we go.
Tear down this wall.
Yes.
Tear down this wall.
I remember that.
Yeah?
I remember that, yeah.
You were there, right?
I wish. I wish I was there for that moment. No, but see, what was so funny, and I don't mean disrespect, but like this is why I roll my eyes. You want to see me roll my eyes?
Yes.
Because conspiracy theorists, yes. You know, I mean, always about this is the end of the world, this is it. And as it is. So when Ronald Reagan was president, there was a big thing came out.
Yes. You know,
that he was the Antichrist.
The Antichrist, yes.
Yeah, because his name, Ronald, is six letters.
Yes.
His last name, Reagan, is six letters.
Six letters, yes.
But there's one more. His middle name is Wilson, which is six letters. They said that's 666.
Dun, dun,
now, I know
dun.
We laughed today, but I'm telling you. And then Mikhail Gorbachev.
Yes.
Well, they said he was truly the Antichrist. Do you have a picture of him?
Yes.
Dude, you got to get a picture because he has a birthmark on his head.
Yes.
And they said that the birthmark was the sign of the Antichrist. All I'm trying to tell you, I've lived for so many – people wonder why I'm so over it. It's because I've lived for so many decades of these – theories and thoughts and accusations. I was talking to one fella, a nice good guy. You got Mikhail's picture there. Oh, that's latter years there, but you can see the birthmark. Yeah. They said that was the mark of the beast.
Mark of the beast.
Now, right, I know there's people out there laughing, oh, or whatever, but I'm going to tell you, in the day, it was like big things, yeah. Christian conspiracy. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, it was a big thing. We seem to live in these conspiracies. We got to live in the word. So, you know, all I'm trying to say is that it's a never-ending thing. So I suppose, you know, Reagan is gone and now Gorbachev, you know what I mean? So that just ends those conspiracy theories, you know?
Yeah, what are they going to do now? Oh, there's always going to be more conspiracy theories.
Well, I was talking to one great guy yesterday.
Yes.
Doesn't come to this church, but yep. I was talking to him, just encouraging him as if things are going. And they had this whole thing during COVID that if you – took the injection.
Yes.
That within, I don't know, 12 months, it's genocide. They're going to kill off the population. And there was all of them.
Oh, no.
So he said to his wife, you know, just this last week, saying, oh, well, I guess that theory of everyone dying who took the shot is not working. You know what I'm saying? So, but I mean, like, I just say, look, it takes faith to get the shot, takes faith not to get the shot. You just work on your own faith and let's not judge each other.
Yes, yes.
But the fact of the matter is all of these conspiracy theories, it's just mind-boggling.
Yes.
You know what I mean? I'm going to attach a little bit of that, so to speak, today, but
that's
later on. But yes, Mikhail Gorbachev, and he's certainly been in isolation. I don't think Putin was a fan.
No, I don't think so either.
Putin was involved in the KGB in East Germany, as far as I understand, and they all blame Gorbachev for pulling apart
the
great
Union.
USSR
yes.
and destroying it.
Yeah.
And I mean, when will that Ukraine war end?
Oh, who knows, Sean?
It's going on forever.
Who knows?
I pray for those people over there, but my goodness, God's grace of the people. But anyhow, do we have some news? Last week was a bit of a funny show. First thing I want to do is welcome Erica.
Erica from America.
It's nice to know. Yes. It's nice to know the camera is working, at least for now. I personally think she sabotaged that camera so that we couldn't see her.
Fingers crossed.
We sort of did a lot of laughing last week.
We did.
We called it the show about nothing. We have a theme on that one?
Oh, yeah. So just in case if we do just start going off talking about nothing, we got the Seinfeld thing just on standby, just so we had something to play underneath.
Yeah. The show about nothing. I'll hope there's a bit more content than nothing.
Yeah.
So should we go to the news?
Yeah. So we got some interesting news, especially of one of the funniest topics I was talking about.
No special music?
No special music because we wouldn't be able to afford it. Because we're talking about cryptocurrency. Everyone's this is the most best thing you can invest in. Of course, I'm not a financial advisor. But
let me say here that the opinions of guests are not necessarily the opinions of the church.
Yes, of course.
Hello, guest.
Oh, I thought I was a co-host. Yeah. Anyway, so there's a crypto...
The opinion of the co-host,
yes,
co-host is not necessarily the opinion of this church.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Ed.
There's a crypto platform called crypto.com, and they were meant to transfer a refund to a Melbourne lady, which was just supposed to be $100, and they accidentally transferred $10.5 million. So...
And how long did it take before the crypto company discovered they'd made a mistake?
I believe they were doing an audit, but it took them about seven months for them to discover it.
And of course, we being such good people saying, excuse me, you accidentally sent me it didn't go that way.
No, it didn't go that way.
So what did this lady do?
Yeah, so instead of the refund, they bought a house.
$1.3 million
house. And they bought a house.
Dispersed the money through different accounts.
So, you know, might not be able to track it. And
All sorts of things. So the court order made her sell the house and pay interest on it.
Yeah.
But they're having trouble finding where all the other stuff
is
because they have dispersed it. So out of 10.5 million, 1.3. Well, it's still over $9 million. So first thing is, Ed, have you ever had a situation, Ed and Erica, where you have been given funds accidentally, which was greater than you should have been?
I don't think I have.
Checking out, like at the cashier, when we used to do a lot more cash, I would get extra change and then give the excess back. I'd confirm.
Okay, that's good. There was a big thing over here or years back where, well, I know that when benefits, you know, for like single family or low income,
yes,
they got overpaid.
Oh.
And then people were coming after them, the government.
Yes.
And there was also the area where I remember in Queensland, the nurses got overpaid.
Oh.
And so the government was going after them, you know, to get it back. Because according to law, you can't keep it. Because they're trying to say, oh, well, it's their mistake. It doesn't work that way.
You, if only.
It's still theft.
Yeah.
There has been many cases in those areas. In fact, the former prime minister and his group brought in what they call, is it RoboCall or something, RoboCenter, which is the current government is trying to stop to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's where people were being contacted robotically to say, you have money, you need to pay it back. And it's seemingly, a lot of it was incorrect. They didn't owe money.
Yeah.
You know, it's quite interesting. So what would, you know, so if you got $10 million.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What would you do, Mr. Ed?
Well, obviously, Sean, me being a good Christian, I would tithe 10% to my house, of course. So I'd be giving $1 million to Dunamis, of course.
We could do a lot with that.
And then the other part of it, I'm also a good son, so I'd pay off my mum's mortgage.
Would you pay off a mortgage or buy her a new house or buy yourself a house?
You know, I'd do both. Why not?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, do both.
Just keep that house for a rental.
Yeah, keep it for a rental. Yep.
Yeah, and then do a new house.
Buy her a new house where she wants it. Yeah.
But what about you? Where would you live?
Where'd I live?
Yeah, like you had that, mate. Where were you going to live?
I don't know. You know what? Stuff it. Italy. I'm going to move to Italy. I'm going to go claim my heritage and see if I can get a passport and citizenship, and I'll just live in Italy.
So you go to Italy.
Yeah.
And where would you live in Italy?
You know, I've tossed it up. I know I don't want to live in the middle because I don't want to live near Rome. But yeah. I think I'd want to live in the south near Sicily.
Sicily?
Yeah, Sicily.
You'd be carrying a violin box.
I would. And I'd be making offers that people can't refuse. That's for sure. No.
They might be making new offers. You can't refuse the fans you're over there. Yeah. So you like the Italian?
Yes, yeah, si, senor.
Yeah, so maybe you'd like to marry an Italian girl.
That would be nice, but there's not a lot of Italians around here. They're all in Adelaide.
Maybe we should do a trip to Italy.
We should. We should do a missions trip to Italy.
Okay. So that area there. Okay. So no motor vehicle, just go relocate.
Yeah, yeah, relocate.
Just live country. On the millions.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, okay. Buy a vineyard or something.
Vineyard? Into alcohol.
Man. No, I'll make a...
You just want to walk on grapes.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a terrible picture in my mind.
You know what? I'll just make pasta or something. How about that? No wine. I'll just make pasta.
Do a couple of cooking courses.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So we'll go, what would you call your restaurant?
I'd call it...
Eduano's.
Yeah, Eduardo's.
Eduardo's. Eduardo's spaghetti.
Well, I can't call it Spaghetti Eddie's because that's already a copyright.
He sold it. Yeah, yeah, Then we'd have a logo of, you know, the dog, the tramp Disney, and they have the noodle down to kiss.
You want to come on
the
kiss?
Yeah, yeah, we'll do that. So, Miss Erica, if you received $10 million, what would you do?
Yeah, I'm currently on the drawing board.
I'm
considering the options. But definitely, I would invest at least 40% of it. Okay. And then, yeah, I don't have a ton of answers at the moment. But I would make sure that I get to see my family once a year. That would be a priority. Okay. But otherwise,
would you tithe?
Oh, yes, of course.
Oh, very good.
That's the first thing you do, of course.
I know people who won money in that. They don't tithe.
They don't tithe it, yeah.
They just take it and run.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's the first course of action,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah, yeah,
of course,
yeah.
Of course.
And then go from there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Maybe get a financial advisor if it was all at one time, potentially. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, well, it's different to Australia to America. Like over here in Australia, if you won something, there's no tax. In America, it's like 40% tax, I think it is.
Oh, my goodness.
40% tax. I remember there's a program where people were winning a lottery, and the lottery company would go to the door, but the tax office agent would also come to the door, present their bill.
No, oh my!
Because remember, it was a tax officer got Al Capone.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
It didn't matter how many people he murdered or did anything else. It was the tax. Got him on tax. You know what I mean? So, do what you want, but just don't touch the money.
Yeah, yeah. Don't mess with the tax department. What would you do, Sean? What would you do if you had $10 million? Just dropped in your lap.
Well, I mean, obviously, I'd tithe. Yes, and then I would like to give a little bit more to some specific purpose areas. That's what I want to do. I'd still be in the ministry.
Yes.
Because the ministry is not a job.
Yes.
I think I'd use the money to finish off the church.
Yes, yes, awesome. Let me
get that done. There'll be a couple mil, get that done out of there.
Yep.
Probably just pay off my son's mortgage and do some other stuff there, a couple of secret gift things in the ear to people.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, and try to hide that I actually got it.
Yes, yes, yes. Exactly. Yeah.
You know, so... But just try to do things in the right way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, but just try to hide it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't think you'd see any change. You know, I'm not going to be driving around in anything else rather than Toyota. So I'll still be still driving the Toyota van. You know what I mean? No, but I mean, like, there's other things I want to do.
Yes, yes.
You know what I mean? So, because I'm very content, you know what I mean, and happy in the area. There's things that can do and power. I'd like to use the money rather than the money use me.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's it.
And
that's
you know, many people's lives have changed with money.
Yeah,
they've become not very nice.
Yes,
and that's the great tragedy. And I'm talking about Christians, not un-Christians. So, yeah, you know, if money changes you, then there's something corrupt. You know, and that's one of the tragedy. I mean, I'm very fortunate. I had the real estate ring me up yesterday.
Oh,
I said, how did you get my phone number? Yeah. It was hard calls.
Yeah.
I said, how'd you get my phone number? They said, some time back, you and your wife went to a home look place, you know, when they got a helmet for sale and go viewing or something.
Oh, okay.
I said, the only one I went to was 8 years ago.
Oh, my goodness.
It was Grace Jeeves across the road. I think it was eight years ago. I said, but 8 years ago. Oh, yeah, that'll be right. I said, man, you must be scratching the barrel after 8 years to dig up my name. Still got on the records. You know, they taught you like your best friends. She says, you want to sell your house? I said, no. Well, how about we come over and give you a valuation? I said, I'm fine. Well, how about I come over and have a look? I said, don't want you to have a look. Well, how about we just have a conversation? I said, I don't want a conversation. Well, what if I told you I had someone in the area who might be interested in buying a house? I'd say I'm not interested. When would you be interested? I don't know. Would you ever be interested? Probably. When would that be? I said, I have no idea. Mate, you're wasting my time. I said, I'm not selling. Thank you very much. You have a good day. You know what I mean? I'm serious. This is yesterday. I don't know who this guy is, but he talked like we're best buddies. So whoever it is, seemed like we had some tight relationship some time back, but I just can't remember it. So I think they're really looking for houses.
Hey, yeah.
But I also read that it has already reached its peak. I think it's back in April, they said, was the peak. And I think they said it's dropped about 1.2%. Is it 1.5? I mean, it doesn't sound a lot, but that could be $13,000 to $15,000
on
the sale. So, I mean, it doesn't affect me because I'm not selling.
Yeah.
And I'm not, see, you know what stops me from wanting to sell?
Grandkids?
No, buying.
Oh, yes. Buying. Oh.
Buying. Oh. I think you'd be worse off, more debt.
Yeah.
You know, I'm debt free. Mm. I don't want that area. Like, want it again. Buying.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Buying. That's the headache.
Ah.
You know what I mean? Dude, this is going to get knocked about, kicked in the teeth.
Yes, yes.
All they want you to do is sell. Praise God for his grace.
Yes, amen.
But anyhow, such is.
Yeah.
So what else do you have on that news front, my friend?
Well, speaking of homes, the Brisbane City Council has begun its home buyback.
Begin or begun?
It just says begins. Hey.
It has begun.
Okay, fine. Begun. It has begun. Stand by. The buyback for the first $50 million round of funding. So 16 Brisbane home owners indicated they wanted their homes bought back under this voluntary scheme. Definitely not building a new highways and stuff like that.
Yeah, well, that one's down this way.
Yeah. The Queensland government has set eligibility criteria and rules around the funding.
Is your house got flooded?
Yeah, if your house got flooded. In Ipswich, there are 32 residents that have indicated they want their houses bought back. In the Sunshine Coast, there are 4. 21 in Logan, 16 in the Fraser Coast, 25 in the Moreton region area. So,
But that was just Brisbane City Council had the 50 million.
Yeah, had the 50 million, I guess.
But I also read there, I think like out of like so many thousands of houses were flooded, there's only a handful that actually want to have it bought out.
Yeah, have it bought out, yeah.
They have got to, it's not an alternative, they have got to buy out Lismore.
Yeah.
I mean, God help those lovely people, but Lismore just got inundated one after another. They've got to relocate that town.
The whole town, yeah.
They've got to just do something.
Yeah.
Why don't they? Have you ever been on a boat area like where they tied the boat, the marinas?
Yeah, I've been to a marina. Yeah.
And they had those big long pillars and the pontoons float up with the water down. Why can't they build houses like that? No. No, dude, you're laughing at me, okay? But I'm telling you, why don't they do it? See if you can Google a house on a floating.
Oh, yeah.
For flooding. Are you doing a sign for it? Right? I think it's a great idea. If it's a flood area.
Yeah.
Right? So why don't they. You're doing a sign for it. Why don't they do it to where if the flood comes in, the house can like just somehow start, like, be lift lifted up?
That's a lot of weight, though. It's like.
No, it's not. It's balanced off.
Well, I mean, like a whole house, that's like real heavy.
But there's.
Well, you engineer it.
There's houses built on stilts, like similar concept, right?
Well, if you try and find some of those houses.
Excuse me.
Who did you get there?
Just blank screen.
If you can sell those houses in Virginia, okay, they're on these stilts like about 30 feet high. They look ugly as sin. I mean, ugly. You find those houses there, I wouldn't buy one. They're so ugly. There are, because it's just a flat little shawl of sand. And in Virginia, they get these hurricanes that come in and this water comes up. And they are so high, you need a packed lunch just to get up those stairs. I mean, it's so high or lift. I don't know how retirees survive.
Yeah, all houses should look like this. Go for it. Go. Well, all houses should look like that, maybe.
Oh,
No. That's like a houseboat.
Well, okay. What if that's the future, though? Houseboats.
It's not the future.
Well, Afghanistan had a
Afghanistan a, doesn't a major have an
flooding.
Ocean.
No, but they had flooding recently, I heard.
Yeah, well, obviously. So, I mean, they'll have flooding.
I mean, you know.
It's very rare they even get rain.
Climate change and all that kind of stuff. If we start seeing more floods, maybe the new housing standards will be your house has to be able to float.
Okay, let me ask this. You have to.
Sent you some photos.
Okay, send a photo. You have to admit, Ed,
yes?
that there has been, I'm going to skip, there has been some climate changes. Would you not agree?
There has been, yes. It feels a lot more hotter and colder.
I mean, see, look at that house. Where's that one?
Virginia.
Virginia. Look at that house. Oh, no, look at the size of the stilt.
Massive.
It looks like a spider that's just walking.
Yeah, hey.
But there's no stairs on it, Erica.
I don't know.
There's a whole one on the coastline. Try and find the whole coastline of the houses on stilts.
Okay.
All right.
I mean, here are people that refuse to allow water to stop them. Why don't we just invest in out Lismore and give them legs?
Give them all legs, all the houses legs.
It'll be cheaper than buying them out. Raise them all up.
Raise them from the dead.
Lift them all up.
Lift them all up. I mean, you know, we have all this dirt lying around, I noticed, from like mining places. No, why don't we just move the dirt there?
It won't, because it just causes water to go elsewhere.
Oh, okay.
You've got to be able to lift them up. So it should be that if you know the flood's coming, that they lift up the house.
Yeah. So should it be stilts, floats, or everyone just gets houseboats now?
Well, I think stilts is hard if you're older. So I think it should be. He's a cheeky guy. I think it should be like a pontoon.
Like a pontoon, all right.
But you should be able to activate it and it goes up.
That would be pretty cool, actually.
And so the electricity is coiled while it goes up.
Ah, yeah.
And you have to do the plumbing somehow to be able to do that as well. But I reckon it should lift up. Mm. Well, it'd save a lot of heartache.
It would, though.
I'm not finding a good photo. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Okay.
But, turn the Seinfeld off, okay? But I reckon it would be logistically better.
It would, anything would be better than what they currently have right now, definitely.
Yeah, just what are they going to do, buy it out and do what?
I don't know. Maybe you could do a
how are those people going to, I mean, how do you know how much you're going to get?
Yeah.
It's now classified as flood, so your value's gone down.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's true. With the blood.
So you're going to get bought out. You can't buy another house.
Yeah, unless you want
to
live in Woodridge.
If they gave me a choice, right, to buy it out or to put stilts, I'd go stilts.
Yeah, you know what? Me too. It'll be
because I still got a house.
Yeah,
you're not
going to
get another house. You know?
I wonder how difficult that would be, though, to do a conversion.
Well, they do it in Virginia. They lift houses up all the time.
Oh, really? Is that like
they relocate homes all the time. They get the tracks, they take them off and relocate. I mean, mind you, not if it's a cement slab.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about a cement slab, which we're talking about. I'm talking about lift houses up, get them up.
Dang.
It's got to be better than losing it.
I wonder what kind of industry that would be. Like an industry that just
house
like...
House removalists.
Oh, where they would remove it, put stilts, put the house back on.
Yeah.
Oh.
They just do sit, lug, build it up.
Oh, okay.
You see, Pastor Shane's house is about 20-something feet high off the ground.
Yeah.
Not the lower level, but the top level. Well, no, because it was a relocated home. That was a home from elsewhere.
His home's been relocated.
Yeah, and he bought it, and they transported it on trucks.
Yeah.
And they put the... You're doing a sign for me. And they put the stilts there and they put it up. You're a goose. For me, I think you're asking an intelligent question, but I think it's...
What are we talking about? Stilts.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Tell me something else.
All right. So we also have that the Victorian Liberal Party has been infiltrated by Pentecostals. Dun, dun, dun. Oh, no. Those... Pesky Pentecostals have infiltrated the government.
Sounds like the media is really angry at Christians, especially Pentecostals.
Yeah.
I forget all the years that story. Was it about 2018, 2019?
Yeah, 2019, Brian Heath joined the Victorian Liberal Party.
Yeah, he used to be a Family First member.
Ah, yep.
And I think he's a pastor or something.
He's
connected somehow to a church.
Yeah, he invited a Malaysian pastor, Jonathan David.
Yeah, a lot of people know Jonathan David.
Yeah, he was a part of an international apostolic network. And he encourages churches to penetrate and conquer the nation.
No, he gave a prophecy. Didn't he say you've got free elections? To influence
the
government.
In the next three terms of the election in this nation are very critical because it's going to chart the course of the end time. Dun, dun, dun.
The church must awaken. And so they began to infiltrate by putting in, I don't know, whatever else. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're Pentecostal, Jewish, whatever else. Mm. It's still a democracy.
Yes.
You're allowed to run.
Yeah.
And every people group has... in some way, an agenda.
Yes.
I mean, the Labour Party has an agenda.
Yes.
It's called communism. Okay? So, well, socialism.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you bring up communism because of Gorbachev.
That's right. I mean, look at those strikes in New South Wales, every day they're protesting. But it's only because the election's going to come up. That's what it's all about. Mm. Then there's other strikes going on there. It's like... Yeah.
Yes. Man. Yes, it'd be interesting to see if New South Wales would ever flip.
Well, you know, back when Ronald Reagan was the president, it was all of the traffic controllers did strike as federal government.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So this is your history, Erica.
Mm, Erica.
So do you know what Ronald Reagan did? You know what he did?
He didn't do anything?
He fired them all.
Oh, whoa. He just fired a whole department.
All across the whole country.
What?
Mm. I got a friend. His name's Mickey.
Yeah.
And he was one of those air traffic controllers that got fired. He still does not like Ronald Reagan. If he is listening, I'm in trouble. Okay. Uh-oh. But the fact of the matter is that that's what happened there. So he fired them.
Oh, my goodness.
Fired them.
Just all of them. Wow.
Says, forget about it. You and your union. I'm going to redo it all. Just get the army temporarily to run the thing and train up.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, you're just holding the country at bay. So.
Oh, my goodness.
It's knowing how far to push, how far to give.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just ridiculous, all these things there, but it happens. But, yeah, I mean, like, you know, I am a born-again, spirit-filled Christian.
Yes.
And certainly I have goals. Now, I think I'm quite timid compared to some of my, fellow pastors. For me, I just really want to have a balanced moral area.
Yes.
I don't want a prime minister preaching the gospel.
Yes.
That's the job of the priests.
Yeah, yeah.
But I do want prime minister or people in political position to be balanced and wise and to think of the well-being. Now, it's correct. I am pro-life.
Yes.
I've never hidden that. Mm-hmm. And as much as I'm pro-life, I don't believe I can force my beliefs on others. So if you, Ed or Erica, were in a political position of power, what would you do about abortion?
Well,
I don't know if it has to do with being in that kind of position, but I think that...
No, I was meaning if you were in that position.
I have a response, but I don't know if it's pertaining to being in power. But I would... I would ensure that there's increased education, and it's so hard because it's like the hearts of people aren't in the right place right now. Like the motivation is part of the part that's off, I think.
Well, especially in America with Roe versus
Roe v. Wade. Yeah.
Yeah. So anyways.
It's not, you know, the V just means versus.
What?
You said, I know you think it's one word or something.
Oh, I thought it was like a boxing match. Like, no. How it's like V.
The V versus a court case.
Oh, Roe versus Wade. Okay.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like.
Okay, so the point that I'm trying to make is that I would try to highlight the fact that living life and living life well is more important than consequences of actions and the decisions that you make about that. Like actually live your life well instead of having to just manage your consequences, I guess. Does that make sense?
So that means do nothing. Okay. So if you're in a position of influence, okay, and in the area of abortion, what would you do?
So I'd give the people a choice. Either we ban abortion or we...
Ban it.
Yeah, we ban abortion or we ban... Oh, why is
spaghetti.
This... What's the word? What's that thing called where
it's on the tip of your tongue where, but you swallowed it?
The parent who doesn't look after the kid has to pay a certain amount of money. What's that thing called?
Yeah.
What's that thing called?
I don't know.
You know when
I just like to leave him hanging.
The parent who will look after the kid, and then the other parent of the kid has to then pay in a fee because.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I don't know what's that called. Dang it.
I just wish I had the camera go working on time.
Dang it. Okay.
Wait, what?
You know that fee?
Child support.
Child support. Okay. So I'd say, okay, we're either banning abortion or banning child support.
See, I was just
letting
him hang for a while because it's just an area.
That's
you know,
what
when
I
talk, the camera comes back. Yes. Thank you, Erica. Okay. All right.
So that's what I'd do. I'd say we're either banning that or the other. That's what I'd say. And then I think
that if you're running, I would not elect. I would not vote
for you. I mean, I don't think you should elect me.
No, for me is... you know, controversial. Just I do like some way that Donald Trump handled it.
Yes.
That is, okay, when certain federal court judges came up for re-election, mm-hmm. it wasn't that he did that. It just it could come up for anybody, Democrats or anything else. So he leaned towards conservative judges.
Yes.
Which, when the liberals are in, when I say liberals, I'm talking about our liberals, but the Democrats are in there, they would lean towards theirs, as yes. they have done already with a pointy. The second thing is, he made it known. He said, I am pro-life.
Yes.
In fact, he was the first president who ever went to a pro-life rally.
Yes.
So he made it known that he's pro-life. Mm. Now, the other thing is, Erica's smiling because she's working hard to switch. The other thing is, no. is that he said, I'm not allowing federal money to fund this.
Yeah, yeah.
So this has to be something you work out in a few states.
Yes.
So I think that was a positive thing too.
Yes, I agree with that too. Yeah.
And so I don't think that I can handcuff a woman because she's planned to do that. Mm-hmm. I agree that I would share my view and not.
Yes.
But the fact of the matter is I would make sure that the said money's up to get. Now, there are cases, of course, where it's life-threatening. Mm-hmm. And there are cases that we know that need to be considered. Yes. Rape, whatever else. Again, I'm not a woman. Mm-hmm. So I do not feel I'm qualified to be able to say how a woman should or should not handle that situation.
Yes.
But I do know a lady who was raped. Mm-hmm. She was in the U.S. Army. Mm-hmm. And she was raped. And she chose not to abort that child.
Mm. Yes.
And she tells a story, you just weep. And she adopted out that child. Yes. She couldn't stand to keep the child because of the memory. She now has a family of several.
Yes.
You know, it's a long time ago. But that was just a remarkable story. Mm. And, you know, they have to. So it's a difficult thing, you know what I mean? And it doesn't matter what you say, you can make people angry. So
yes.
It's just a very difficult thing, you know. So, you know, government is a hard thing. I'd hate to be in government.
Yeah.
So
government doesn't have to worry. I'm not heading towards any directions of those things.
Yet.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, you're going to ask.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so we're not in political power. As a pastor, I think purity is part of the answer, but not everyone has that conviction. And I also think that sometimes purity as a topic was taken to an extreme that was unhealthy as well. What's the solution for the generation coming up to empower them with the concept of purity and
yeah. Well, I mean, as a pastor, which is different from being a politician,
exactly. Okay, clarifying. Yeah.
I'm praying for a move of God.
Yeah.
But the move of God starts within me.
Mm. Yes.
See, the move of God is not something I want to see to happen in that teenager. It moves in me.
Yes.
And the first sign should be the move of God in me yes. is my compassion or love.
Yes.
It shouldn't be my judgmental message. It should be my compassion or love. And I think that what this generation needs is the message of Jesus.
Yes.
Yes.
And it has to be a demonstration of compassion and love. It's that care.
Mm.
And I think that's most important. Mm. But people pray for a move of God. The word revival is not even in the Bible.
Yeah.
Okay. People say, come this Friday, we got revival. It's just ridiculous, the wordplay.
Yes.
But we need a touch of God. We need a touch of the Holy Spirit. I've been fortunate. I've seen three moves of God.
Yes.
Seriously, three moves in my life.
Yes.
One was when I got saved in the 70s, and it was a supernatural called the Charismatic Renewal, which is incredible, the people.
Yes.
The second one was when I became a youth pastor. And in 12 months, we saw such a move of God where hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of kids came in. Hundreds. It was just phenomenal. We went from a youth group when I took over about 100 to over 600.
Yeah.
Or 600. That was in life groups. On the Saturday, it's more like 400.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, but I mean, that's how it went in the different groups. Then the third time I saw a move of God was probably the sixth year of this church. Mm. Maybe the fifth, sixth year, maybe. For maybe 2 years, maybe yes. three. We just saw a move of God where I just couldn't keep up with people. Yeah, I mean, in one part it was good, and the other part it wasn't good.
Yeah.
I was not prepared for it.
Yes.
And trying to manage it and work it was really, really hard. But there was something just supernatural. Supernatural. And like what happens after a move of God, like what happened in the Welsh Revival, Azusa Street Revival, with Jonathan Edwards, with wherever you want to go, then these cracks come where people fight against each other or they clamor for position or whatever else, and it happens, regrettably.
Yes.
And that's the sad thing. So I can tell you now, I have seen three extreme moves of God in my personal life, mm-hmm. Which I bear witness to.
Yes.
And no matter what happens after each time, you still pray the same thing. God, do it again.
Yeah.
God, do it again. God, do it again. God, do it again. Mm. And I've been feeling, and I heard Josiah say this the other Sunday, maybe Jacinta said something too, I don't know. But they're just saying they can feel this, like it's an edgy feeling, like they can feel like maybe something's starting to stir. Now, when I say stir, it doesn't mean we've seen the full fruits of it. We haven't seen the fruits of it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But there's this, I feel this little stirring of the pool, you know what I mean? Like, and then you're asking, is it? Is it? Is it something? Is
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah.
And I just feel it. This is a little edgy touch. I mean, I don't know how you feel. You know what I mean? I love it when your husband leads worship. Andreas. I mean,
yes.
I just love, probably one of the things I love about, there's certain people you feel like, if I use this word, I don't mean it literally, like you do a dance with them. I don't mean, like I love riding a motorbike with Danny.
Yeah.
Right? Because we will ride and either he's in front or I'm in front and we just sort of sway. Same thing I like on a PWC. You can just ride. Well, with Andreas, I love, is it's just like he just seems to have this ability that if I'm speaking to know what song to do, come in. And he just seems to, it's just like the dance on. Like I don't have to say, he just knows, he's listening. Is he, what happens, he listens? So it's a combination of him listening plus his spirit.
Yes, yes.
The third thing is that he's prepared to go out of his comfort zone.
Yes.
Because he'll work towards a song that's probably not one of his songs, but he knows it relates towards me there. This is a beautiful thing. And this is how you see God's moving.
Yes.
It goes beyond where, this is how we lose God's moving. It then becomes about the individual wanting their way.
Yeah.
Well, I want my time on the platform, or I want this direction to go.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But I can say, and I feel that with Josiah as well.
Mm-hmm.
I feel with Josiah, I think this is the third year now in his position, and I feel even more so now. There's a more of a flow. You can just say it just, and there's like a dance, like a swoon, like a dance, and I feel that's very encouraging, and that's something that I've. But you know, I want to move with God. If we want to change this nation, it won't be because of laws.
Yes,
because so and it won't be because we dictate or we threaten people. It have to be the grace of God. I don't pray for the seven mountains.
Yeah,
I don't pray to reveal the Antichrist. I pray for a sweeping touch of God.
Yes.
But it begins in me.
Yes, individual.
And rather than us preach at others, and rather than us condemn others, and rather than us be, you know, it begins with me.
Yeah.
But we're so absorbed today with our own hurts, our own dissatisfaction. When you're so absorbed, the Bible says, give and shall be given back.
Yes.
Out of your own need, give.
Yes.
Out of your hurt, give. You know, like someone says, nobody invites me out for a meal. Then you invite people out for a meal.
Yeah.
Nobody says hello. Then you start the ministry of hello.
Yes, yes.
So sometimes what you may see as a weakness in the church somewhere else could be God speaking to you to fill because you become aware of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Why isn't anybody bringing in the lost? Then you bring in the lost.
You start it, yeah.
You know what I mean? So many times I find, or like someone has, you get a painter says, why isn't anybody painting the wall? Well, you're a painter. You paint the wall.
Yeah, you
can
you do
see. Because in your trade, you can see things.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and we have this attitude. Like it was one brother just this week was helping out, just blessing us, helping us out, doing some construction.
Yeah.
And another Christian brother rang him up on the Saturday. He was in here working. And he says, hey, I'm going out here. You want to come? He goes, no, I can't. I'm doing this work.
Yeah.
And the other Christian brother said, well, why'd you do that? You're not getting paid.
Mm.
I mean, the other brother is a good guy, but you wonder, like, where we're at. Is church just one service on a Sunday?
For what, a couple of hours?
Yeah. Well, not if you're at the eighth.
Not if the eighth, just 1 hour, yeah.
You know, but I mean, like, is that all churches come down to now? It's like, what do I get out of it? What do I do? You know, and that's why there isn't a revelation of the word. It's not a revelation of the Spirit of God because, you know, if you understand the joy in your salvation, there's liberty. And the joy of the salvation means you go. I know one guy who says, well, he's going to one church and his wife and family aren't going to that church. Mm. And like, so he's set to try and convince them. And I'm like, I haven't shared it because the guy won't talk to me. But the fact you may say, well, where's love? See, the definition of love is denial of self for the benefit of others.
Yes, yes.
So this guy functions in lust. So lust is this benefit of self at the expense of God and others.
Yeah, yeah.
So this guy's consumed with the lust. I'm not talking about sexual lust, but the lust of another position, of a thing, rather than the love of his family. So rather than saying, I'll know it's God if my family in agreement, it's like, well, this is it, they're wrong. And you see, this is where we miss it. And how are we going to see the move of God unless something happens? But here's the thing. It's no good being judgy at the church.
Yes.
You bunch of slackers, you're not praying. It's no good being judgy at the church. Why aren't you bringing life? It's got to start in us. And if it can start, if everyone takes responsibility for their own fire.
Yes.
Meaning we've got to stoke it.
Yeah.
You know, we've got to keep it growing. That's what Paul says to Timothy. You know, I want you to fan into a flame.
Yes.
So that's the closest thing we have in the New Testament to the word revival. Bring back to life. I mean, it's not extinguished, but the coals or the embers are red, but they're not creating the heat or the fire. And we need to fan into a flame what once burnt so bright and clear. And I think if we could just get revival in our heart, our church, and I'm church inclusive, not a church.
Yeah.
And this nation needs Jesus.
Yes, amen.
And we may well be the only Jesus they'll see.
Yes.
Yep.
So we have got to start reflecting Jesus. And we're not. Because we are consumed with our own want, needs, and feelings of neglect. And unless we learn to overcome that, we will not see the move of God.
Yeah, yeah.
We will not see God's touch. I've seen three moves, and I've been absolutely just in awe. You know what the problem is in the move of God?
What's that?
You normally don't know you're in one.
Yeah, that's so true.
And every move of God I've been in, I didn't realize I was in one until after it went.
Wow. Oh, yeah, yeah.
And after
yeah.
it went, I went, oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Because you just, you're either so caught up in it, or you take it for granted.
Yeah, yeah.
And That's a great tragedy, you know, and it breaks my heart. So I keep saying, Lord, sweep over my soul.
Yeah.
Sweep
yeah.
over it. But, you know, going back to whether it be Andreas or whether it be my son, that's where I feel a great, you know, of course, my wife, we are as one.
Yes.
You know
what I mean?
But that's to me is a big heart cry that we've got to be hungry for God. We've got to stop complaining about what the church or the team's not doing. If you see a gap, fill it.
Fill it, yeah.
If you think there's an area of lack in pastoral care, then you start filling it.
Yes, yes.
If you feel there's a lack in the area of reaching out and touching, then reach out and touch.
Yeah.
You know, a burden halved is the burden shared.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
But trying to put all the burden on to one person or one group, you know, we're very fortunate in this church for the number of pastors and staff we have.
Yeah, yeah.
But at the same time, it can make the congregation lazy. Because they can say, well, I don't get paid to do that. And we've got to rally together.
Yes, yes.
I mean, you take the Hillsong situation.
Yeah.
I don't know, much more happened since the other time we shared. But, you know, everybody's waiting for the cracks for the breaking open, which is a tragedy. They're like, you know, vultures.
Yeah, yeah.
Just sitting there waiting for destruction. And I'm praying for healing.
Healing, yeah, yeah.
I don't want to destroy. No, I'm not a Hillsong person. Never have been. And I won't will be. But I'm praying for healing.
Yes, yes.
In all areas. I was reading about how there's a particular gentleman, he's a pastor, and he just received an award not long ago from the government.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he's a lovely man. Okay, but he openly shares about how he was one of the key players to have Brian Houston arrested.
Oh,
by sharing information that he'd dug up and researched and not sharing it, and on the area there.
Yep.
And you know, of course, I believe in justice, and I'm not saying it's wrong, but you know, even if he was involved, to go out there and start saying, "Well, I was a key player in the area of doing these things here," it's just. You know, and I'm sure he's a good man. He's a pastor of a church in New South Wales. But, you know, do we hate someone this much?
To be like prideful about it or proud.
Well, I guess, I don't get it. I mean, he says he worked a couple decades He was a part of that church for a couple of decades in a different field.
Yeah.
And now he's a pastor's an area. But his lead title on his page as pastor is, don't go to a place because of worship, don't go to a place because of the building, just come, you know, quote Spurgeon, an area here.
Yeah.
And there's truth in what he says, but, you know, the devil, the serpent, never told a lie to Eve.
Yeah, yeah.
It just wasn't the full truth.
Yes, yes.
And that's what happens today. Do I think Brian should be held accountable? I think all of us should be held accountable.
Yep.
But what I get concerned about is, even if you were used to help accountability, why do we want to go into the media and say, well, I'm the one to help pull down that thing. I'm the one to do that. I just don't see how that works in the body of Christ. And, you know, I don't see it. Yeah. I mean, you know, I could comment easier about Brian's situation with those two women by texting in the room because of alcohol and either sleeping tablets or anti-anxiety tablets. But the one way he's being held accountable for, you know, what he did or didn't do about his father's thing, he didn't do those things his father did.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just think it's a bit of a gray area because there was no law during that time that you had to bring it in. So I just don't know, except that he was under oath and he probably said no. So I don't know. So, but I suppose we'll find out. But, you know, it's bad enough we fight this world, right? Yeah. But it seems like our greatest battle is within.
Yes.
The church is just fighting itself.
Yeah, yeah.
We are fighting each other. And to me, that just breaks my heart.
Yeah.
It's just, it can't be right.
Yeah.
It can't be right. It just can't be right. There's got to be more to it.
Yes.
Yes.
But, you know, I love our team. I see, you know, Pastor Danny.
Yes.
He's a good man, isn't he? Huh? He's our community pastor.
Yes.
He's just so fired up with doing this new venture for the community food things and building it a whole new room.
Yes.
That guy is just incredible.
Crazy.
I mean, crazy. Then I see Kelly.
Yes.
We got this business given to us.
Yep.
Which does, what do you call it, like hampers?
Yeah, hampers.
Gift hampers.
Premium.
Premium.
Premium hampers.
Prestige.
Prestige.
Prestige. Sorry, I used to be about Prestige hampers that runs in the area of the church. And so they're doing, and she's just so excited about that area, which is wonderful. And it's just great, you know, hearing all of these things, you know.
Actually, they're looking for a tagline for the business. So if anyone out there is really good at catchy taglines that leave a lasting impression, reach out.
I gave six. That means I rejected everyone.
Maybe you gave that since I talked to them. So I'm not sure.
Well, how long ago did you talk to them?
Yesterday.
Yeah, I did it a week ago.
Okay. Boom. Yeah, sorry for the bad news.
I said, have a catch cry that goes like, Prestige hampers. When your customers have value. Prestige hampers. When your customers mean something.
Except for I think the actual title of it is not actually Prestige Hampers. It's something else.
But just told me it was Prestige.
Prestige is the first name, isn't it? But that's not the whole entire title. I don't know exactly what it is.
Okay, well,
you're just to say.
All right, well, I'm going to look on my phone because Kelly sent me a thing on it.
Okay.
Oh, it's called Platinum.
Oh, Platinum. Oh, it's called
Platinum Showcase Promotions.
Premium Prestige Platinum.
You said Premium. Excuse what did me. You say? Prestige?
No, opposite, yes.
I just jumped there. It's Platinum. All right. I'm going to send this to you, Edward, so you can put it up there.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Let's advertise. Yes.
Let's advertise. It's called Platinum.
All
right, check it out.
Okay. Showcase Promotions. There you go.
Platinum Showcase Promotions.
I'm glad I brought
Boy,
that
Boy, we
up.
Were all so close. All right. It's the three Ps.
The three Ps.
It's the Platinum Showcase Promotions.
There you go.
That's a cracker. Hey, have we got any pictures of the gifts we're giving away for Father's Day?
Ooh.
Oh, I know I should have taken a photo of them.
I asked Kelly for these pictures.
I can tell you what they. I remember looking at it.
I know this Sunday is Father's Day.
Father's Day, yeah.
Okay, and Father's Day always falls on the same time as my wife's birthday.
Yes.
So my wife said to me, "Why don't we do a dinner for Father's Day and her birthday? Because Father's Day is the 4th, her birthday is the 5th."
Yeah, yeah.
I said okay. That was like a week ago, so. Today, my beautiful wife, who I'm crazy about, said to me, hey, I want to change where we're going to eat. Seemingly, the Sheraton does buffet again.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I sound so American. We need buffet.
Buffet.
Kind of just be a la carte, just serve us on the table. So we went from a la carte, we get served at the table, to it's going to be buffet.
Yeah.
It's during this time, Eric, is a good time to try and talk to Kelly.
I'm working on it. I'm working on it.
And so what happens is, so this morning she says, I've changed my mind, Sean, where I want us to have this meal.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, okay.
Yeah.
She says, I think I have the right to pick because it is my birthday. And I went, but I thought it was also Father's Day.
Oh, also Father's Day.
I thought it was Father's Day. I didn't say Father's Day. But I said, okay, honey, just do whatever you want.
You know
what I mean? Maybe I'll get a little mention in there for Father's Day. But that's it. But that's okay. That's not my love language. So whatever. So praise God. But that's what happened.
Yeah.
So Father's Day. So anyhow, blah, blah, blah. Comes in. So at church this Sunday,
yes,
I have Sandra who is going to be sharing the word with us.
Yes.
I'm awesome. Pretty excited about that.
Yeah, me too.
Do you know why I got her? It might sound funny. Why have I got a lady sharing on Father's Day?
Yeah, why do you, Sean? That's a bit wacky.
Because
you wacky Pentecostals.
Because I want her to share from a different perspective because every girl has a daddy.
Yes.
And I'd like to hear from the perspective of a girl.
Yes.
Okay, in the context of her view of dad. And I think that there's three males who played a role in a lot. Just do this pictures up for me one at a time. Can you do that for me?
Yeah, sure.
So this here, I want you to put this picture up first.
And got it.
Okay, so put that up.
Yeah, you can show it up.
All right. This is in the 1800s. He was a missionary to China. Okay, they're Lutheran and Dutch and all those areas, okay? And they were missionaries to China, okay? Yes.
This is Rudolf Christian Frederick.
Yeah. Leecher? In the south Leecher? Of China it was, which is from Hong Kong up the area there.
Yes.
All right? And in those middle to late hundreds, this is one of the – it's an old photo because we're talking about 18-something.
Yeah.
One of the converts. And it was quite a big deal, you know, to say, for that to happen, all right? Mm. So she's one of the converts, found Jesus from the missionary.
Yeah.
Okay. And in fact, in Kowloon, Hong Kong, she's buried up there in the Christian grave, which is quite interesting, okay? And then her daughter, I sent it to you.
Got it.
She got saved. Photos aren't the best, okay? But then she got saved,
yeah.
All right? So the missionary to the daughter here, and then she brought her daughter into the saving knowledge of Jesus, okay? This lady's still alive. She's 97 years young.
Mm, wow.
And then she shared to her daughter, okay, who's my wife.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean? And then, of course, it goes to my son and everything else. So
this
is just an amazing story, okay, how it happened. But it's Father's Day, not about mothers, okay? But the fact of the matter is that what I love about this story, okay, is the power of how she sees it. So I said to my wife, let's go up to your daddy's grave.
Yes.
So I did a picture on Tuesday. Okay, this is here.
Yeah.
And that's her father. I don't know if you can zoom in at all on her dad. Okay. But he died in 1974. Now, my wife was 18.
Oh, wow.
And her daddy was 57.
Yeah.
That's traumatic for a young girl.
Mm,
okay.
Yes.
And so she's just going to share about, even though he believed in God, had a belief in God, he never shared it to his family.
Mm.
And so I said to her, why don't you share just from that, you can zoom back out, why don't you just share in that perspective, that Mount Kavat area there. So I said, why don't you just share in the perspective of what Father's Day is to you?
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
What's Father's Day to you?
Yeah, yeah.
Now she has a husband who's a father.
Yes.
And she has a son who is a father.
Yes.
But why don't you just share, I said to her, from your perspective.
Mm.
And, you know, sometimes it doesn't always have to be about men sharing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sometimes you want to hear children share.
Yes. Yes.
And I said to Sandra, I don't think the church has ever heard you share about your dad and your dad's experience. So I said, bless me and do that. Then in the afternoon from 4 o'clock, 2:30.
2:30.
Ed, we'll have some giveaways. The other one's downloading now.
Oh,
the show.
Yeah. We've got some photos coming.
So
stand by for that.
At 2:30, we have our market.
Yes. Right?
And all the normal things, the food, the produce, and And we do those Kranskis.
Oh my god.
Okay, and all the food things we do.
Okay, Ed has three photos now.
But we've got these giveaways, and we spent a few grand just getting some giveaways.
Is that the third one's coming now?
So I think they're doing the giveaways at 3:30, 4 o'clock, and
4:30. And there will be more professional photos and video tomorrow as well.
Yeah, so this is just rough right now. Yeah. So can you put anything up?
So we got a TV.
So what size? 65.
65 inch. 4K. 65 inch TV. Baby. 4K.
Boy, I hope it's better than that box. Yeah, 65 inch is a good size, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all right.
It's massive. It's a massive box.
Yeah, we're giving that away for nothing.
Yeah, okay. You have to be a father, right? You have to be a father.
Yeah. Okay, what else are we giving away?
We've got some gardening equipment.
A wheelbarrow. I don't know all that stuff. Oh, that hose is on that roundup thing, the retractable hose. And there's a
pressure washer.
And a Bunnings hat, the essential for any gardener.
Yeah, definitely get the thermist.
And the thermist.
Yeah. Do people actually wear Bunnings hats?
There's one more. I do.
Yeah, I do.
A Bunnings hat.
Yes. I wear the smaller rim one.
Oh, no, I don't have it.
You got a photo of you wearing it?
I don't know if I have
it. It's in your text. It's delivered.
Yeah, go off.
Oh, yeah. Hello.
All right, okay, I got it.
No, I don't have a photo of me wearing it.
Here we go.
All right.
Woo.
Okay, so this is the other. So we have an Esky. And that's, you see that Weber?
Oh, Weber?
Yeah. Josiah showed me that Weber. It's like a camping one. You push a button and it collapses all by itself.
Oh, what?
It's like pneumatic.
Fancy. Yeah.
Mm. It just locks down.
Yeah.
That's excellent.
Very, very good. And it's a couple of deck chairs, I think outdoor
fishing
chairs.
Fishing rods.
Oh, fishing rods there too. Yeah, very so important. We're giving all of these away.
Yep.
So they're all going.
And an Esky.
That's like a pack. That's a package, and then the other one's a package, and then the TV.
Yeah.
Oh, so three it's packages. Three.
Yeah.
So when they do it at 3:30, 4 o'clock, 4:30.
4:30 is the TV.
It's all packages.
Yeah, yeah.
So you win that complete package.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you just come, put your name in, we draw it out.
Yeah.
There's no money involved, no anything like that one, just to be a blessing in the community.
Yes. So good.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it.
It's going to be a fun Father's Day.
It will be a fun Father's Day. Yeah. And just having that fellowship out there and just connecting, I think it's a good thing, you know? So we do what we do.
Yes.
Amen. And all our normal stuff there. So we want to encourage people to come along and be a part of it.
Yeah.
Amen. Which is good. I was supposed to share, but I haven't even shared. You know, look at the time has gone. It's almost 12
o'clock. Share, though. You did share some powerful moments in there. Yeah, it might not have been on purpose.
It wasn't the moment I wanted, but anyhow, but it came in there. But be loving.
Yes.
Any more news stories for me?
No, that's it. We finished on time this week.
Yeah. So what was it actually like with your daddy?
What was last year?
No, what's it like with your dad? Is it a good relationship?
Oh, we're currently just having some time apart right now.
Okay, so it's something we pray through, right?
Yeah. Yes.
And Erica, you know, you lost your dad. I met your dad, wonderful man.
Yes.
How long ago is that now?
So he passed away in 2014.
Yeah.
So 8 years.
And my dad on the 17th of September will be 17 years he passed away.
Wow.
Wow.
So is my wife too. So, you know, in other words, you know, cherish the moments you have with your dad. Work to try and reconcile.
Yes.
Mm. Okay. Remember, there aren't any perfect fathers.
Yes.
Okay, except God the Father.
Except God the Father,
And let's just try and reach out. And so I know sometimes a day like Father's Day can also be a difficult day.
Yes.
Because we think of the separation, we think of the hurts, or we can feel the loss.
Mm.
And we feel all of those things.
Mm.
But the issue is that, you know, it works in there.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, I mean, for you, Erica, you get to celebrate Andreas as a dad,
yeah,
so, which is a wonderful thing.
It is. I might have already given him his present. I couldn't wait.
Who, Andreas or Dad?
Yes.
He gave his present. Early.
Oh, was it? Did he like the charger?
Yeah, he did.
He did. I helped her with her present.
It's a 4 meter long charge cable,
like for a phone, like a phone charger cable, massive cable. Woo!
Yep.
All right, put the Seinfeld music back on.
Talking about nothing.
Oh,
all right, so
that's what he asked for.
I have no idea. 4 meter long phone charger.
Yeah,
4 meters.
4 meters. Yeah, so it's more than two. So it's like imagine a 2 meter, then double it. That it's like that.
Anyway,
what would you want a 4 meter phone charger for?
Well, I guess if he's sitting on one side of the counter, the kitchen, and then he can.
Like, but that's just like having a phone that's hardwired.
Yeah.
It's like we're forgetting what a mobile phone is. Oh, yeah, it's like
the purpose of it now, right?
It's like, you know, you have the phone and,
yeah.
And you'd have this long thing you could walk around talking
with. Yeah, and now he's just kind of like...
walking around, yeah, someone's going to trip on it.
Yeah, trip on it, yeah.
I don't get it. Why not? Why not leave the phone on its charge station?
Yeah.
And put on the earbuds. Just put one in.
If you want to do music or something like
that's
that.
That's what I do.
It's for the purpose of watching videos on it. Because he uses his phone battery at work. And so then he needs to.
So let me get right. He watches movies at work, is what you're saying.
No.
You said it's for the purpose of movies.
Why is he on his phone at work?
Why is he on his
phone at work? Okay. Shouldn't he be working?
Seinfeld music is appropriate.
I don't know what. He's using his phone at work.
Yeah.
So the battery's dead and he needs to charge it when he's home.
But what does he use it for at work?
Yeah.
Phone calls all day.
Okay.
All day.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So leave it in the charger.
Yeah.
Put in the earpiece.
You should have gone on an earpiece.
And you go, hello.
Hello.
Okay, I'll make sure I give him that advice.
And it's just stuck there, and no one, it's health and safety, no one's going to trip over
massive 4 meter cable.
Make sure I give him that advice. I'll keep you posted.
I have two sets of
Earbuds.
Earbuds.
Okay, I'll let him know.
But I only put one in the ear.
Yeah, same. I'm the same.
Actually.
And that way I could put the other one in, it goes flat. It's actually charging. I put the other one in.
Yeah, exactly.
Apparently, little kids nowadays answer their phone like this, hello, when they're pretending hello. But my son does this because I'm old school. Oh. But anyways, that's my story.
I just want my son to answer his phone when I ring up.
Okay.
And then when he does answer, I pray Sophia's not in the car.
Yes, so she hangs up.
She goes, hello, hello. No, Zion hangs up because he's watching something.
Yeah.
But Sophia so overrides the phone. Okay. I got to finish. I got to show you. Remember who did that video of my Christmas, you know? And I just... got to show you, Ed. Put it up. This is Christmas last year.
You want to show the video?
How much? No, I don't want to show the video. Just one photo. I did a snap off of the photo.
Yeah, put it up, Eric.
Okay. And this is... look, she had no hair
then.
She's
changed so much.
Oh, yeah. Look at that. Look at her. Isn't she a trip?
Wow. Okay.
I mean, like, she is just so gorgeous. That is Sophia then.
Yeah.
Don't you think it's cute?
Nice.
So zoom cute. Back out again. So good there. That was our Christmas at our house this last year.
Oh, nice.
So she's just so into Aries. She's so cute, man. I can see I love my granddaughter there, but she's just such a trip. I just thought that was such a cute picture. So Zion's passing it out. Christmas is coming soon.
It is. Christmas is coming.
Yeah, I know.
Christmas is coming.
All right. Well, Ed, for a show that really did talk about nothing.
Really did talk about nothing.
It is pathetic, okay?
Yeah.
But it all works out.
Yeah.
So, hey. You guys, I look forward to seeing you on Sunday at our 8 a.m. chapel service, our 9:30 service. We'll be live streaming the 9:30.
Yep.
My gorgeous wife will be sharing on Father's Day.
Yep.
And then from 2:30,
yep.
Should see a dentist, okay? From 2:30, we'll be having our markets and the giveaways and all the foods and all the other stuff. We look forward to seeing you there. Will I see you there?
Yes, I'll be there. I'll be there.
Okay.
I'll be there.
We're coming for the giveaways.
Yeah, she's coming for the giveaways. She ain't much good there. Okay, she hasn't caught that version yet. But anyway. God bless you. Yes. Thank you for coming.
Join us next week for another episode of Absolutely Nothing. Bye, everyone.
Here we are today.